We'll now start to explore the reactions, equations, and pH calculations when we add a strong acid to a buffer solution. First, it's helpful to begin by showing this figure from the textbook that illustrates the difference between an unbuffered and a buffered solution. So here, of course, they're both showing the same pH value. We've added an indicator of methyl orange. On the left, of course, we have the unbuffered solution. On the right, we have a buffer that was made to a pH of 8. In the pair of photos on the right, we have added 1 milliliter of 0.01 molar HCl. This constitutes a very small amount of a strong acid. And notice when the unbuffered solution has the HCl added to it, we see a dramatic color change indicating that there's a dramatic change in pH. So here our pH went down drastically to see a distinct color change like that. But the pH 8 buffer solution on the right had the pH stay about the same. There's no distinguishable change in color here. So adding that little bit of acid had no noticeable effect on the pH. The next thing that we want to talk about is how we identify the equations that will allow us to set up to calculate the pH. So we need to figure out when we add a strong acid, we're going to use HCl, what in our buffer solution it's going to react with. So remember, the two key parts of our buffer, the two key solutions are acetic acid with sodium acetate. We know, of course, that acetic acid is a weak acid, and we know that sodium acetate is a basic salt. If I'm going to add an acid, it is always going to react with a base. And so the HCl is going to react with the sodium acetate in our buffer. To help illustrate that, we are going to draw in our beakers below. In the first beaker, we're going to draw 2 moles of our buffer. So that means we're going to have 2 moles of acetic acid and 2 moles of our sodium acetate. So of course, the sodium acetate completely dissociates. And the number 2 is random. It's a small enough number that we can show what's going on, but large enough to actually see a reaction. In our second reactant beaker, we're going to add 1 mole of HCl. So remember, for HCl, you could draw that dissociated to H plus, or if you wanted to write this as H3O plus, that would also be sufficient. Now, what we want to understand is when we add the HCl into our buffer, what is going to react? And sometimes it's actually helpful to figure out what will not react. Recognize that our sodium ions from the first beaker are going to be completely neutral. They just transfer over. Our chloride ion from the second beaker is also going to be neutral. That just transfers over. So now we need to figure out, when I add the H plus or H3O plus into my first beaker, what is it going to react with? Well, clearly adding acid is not going to react with acid. So my two acetic acids, I can move over. They're not going to participate in this reaction. But now I can tell that my hydrogen ion will react with an acetate. And so I will actually form a third molecule of acetic acid. And that's just going to leave the additional acetate ion left over. So the net reaction that took place, or the molecular reaction that took place, my sodium acetate is what reacted with the HCl to form a new molecule of acetic acid. And some sodium chloride, which of course completely dissociated. So this is of course our molecular equation. When I ask you to write a chemical equation for a reaction, you're welcome to write the molecular, ionic, or net ionic. So this would be our molecular equation to describe what's happening. And again, here is the emphasis of that reaction that's taking place. So it's the sodium acetate in the buffer that's reacting with the HCl. The net result is that the amount of the buffer part of our base decreases while the acid part of our buffer increases, right? We used up sodium acetate, but we created more acetic acid. And the second part we'll describe when we talk about our base. So now we want to determine how we will calculate this new pH. And before we get into that, I want to introduce a new unit for you. So first of all, this is going to be our main problem we're working with, to calculate the pH of 75.0 milliliters of a 0.50 molar acetic acid and 0.50 molar sodium acetate solution. We effectively already did this. Realize that in the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, these are listed as concentrations. Since we already had concentrations, that's all we need to use here. For this example, we don't need to use volume. However, we will need volumes when we add our strong acid or a strong base. Because we always use units of milliliters for our volumes, we never work in liters in chemistry. It's helpful to use a new unit. And for this new unit, what we're really doing is describing a metric prefix that you've already used. So remember, molarity is calculated as moles per liter. And again, we never use liters, but we do know that 1 liter is equivalent to 1,000 milliliters. And so that means that 1 mole would also be equal to 1,000 millimoles. So same milli prefix, we're just using it in front of moles. Of course, those thousands cancel out, and so molarity can just be defined as millimoles per milliliter. And so that means that if I need to calculate moles of a substance, I could actually calculate millimoles by multiplying my molarity times milliliters. On the next slide, I have all of this written out here. The two key things to recognize are how we calculate molarity and how we calculate millimoles. So for purposes of math setups, I'm going to start using millimoles so that you can identify the unit and try to get comfortable using it. If you don't like using the millimole, if you can't get used to it, you're welcome to stick with using moles and converting all your volumes to liters. All right, so our acid problem that we're going to work is here. We're going to add some HCl. So as we already figured out from our drawing, we know that the H3O plus, or just the H plus in the HCl, reacts with the conjugate base, the acetate ion. Since we're adding a strong acid, we know that this reaction goes to completion. And so again, for our molecular equation, it's the sodium acetate reacting with the HCl. Since my HCl is a strong acid, it forces our reaction to completion. To make some neutral sodium chloride, since this is a neutral salt, it's not going to affect my pH, but I will make more of my acetic acid solution. And so here we have our equations. Again, on this row, second row, I have my molecular equation. The first one, I have the net ionic. Either one of those is acceptable to use. Now, the table that we're using here is a slightly different table. Because we have reactions that are going to completion, we need to use what's called a change table. In a change table, we're effectively setting up stoichiometry where we're determining how many moles or millimoles of each substance we're using. So I'm actually going to do my calculations below the table to determine the initial amount of each substance. Remember again that amounts, millimoles, are calculated as molarity times our volume in milliliters. So for my sodium acetate, my concentration is the 0.50 molar. The volume of my buffer is the 0.5 times 75. And so my starting amount of sodium acetate is 37.5 millimoles. Now notice that my acetic acid is going to have the exact same quantity. Because we're starting with the same concentration, and same initial volume. Both parts of my buffer have the exact same amounts of millimoles. That is not always the case. We often start with different concentrations here, but for this example, they are the same. I'm going to go ahead and cross out my NaCl because I know it's neutral. I will form some, but it doesn't matter. It won't affect my pH. And so for my last quantity, I need to know how much HCl I have added. So again, my concentration in molarity times my volume in milliliters means that I have added 5 millimoles of the HCl. Now in our change table, notice our first two rows are the same as what we saw before. We have initial, we have the change line. But since we're not setting up equilibrium, our third and final row we call final. It's how much we're left with at the end of reaction. The nice part about these tables is we can actually determine the amount of change based on limiting reactants. So the next key step in here is to figure out of my two reactants, which one is going to limit how much product I can make. The nice thing about this class is all of the examples that we use are always one-to-one ratios. So whichever reactant has a smaller amount is my limiting reactant. And of course, we know that limiting reactants go to zero at the end of a reaction. So that means that I know the amount of change for everything. All right, my limiting reactant has to decrease by 5, and that means that everything changes by 5. I like putting this squiggly arrow to separate reactants from products because a common mistake I see is students putting minuses all the way across. Remember that products are going to increase. And so we are left with 32.5 millimoles of our sodium acetate, right? The base went down. That means our acid has to go up and it will become 42.5 millimoles. All that's left now is to calculate our pH. So recognize we still have a buffer solution left, right? We have the conjugate base, we have the weak acid, and so now we can use our Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Shortening that to base over acid, B over A. We already calculated our pKa. This is where it's very, very helpful to have written that number down so you don't have to recalculate it every time. And now, of course, we just have to identify which one's the base. That is our sodium acetate. And our acid is the acetic acid. For this equation, we can continue to use millimoles. On the next slide, I will explain why. So once we added a little bit of strong acid, we get a final pH of 4.62. Notice that our pH decreased a little bit. Remember, our initial buffer was a pH of 4.74. So our pH has decreased a little bit with the addition of a little bit of acid. Now on this slide, I want to explain why we were able to keep our units in millimoles. And it's because if I was going to convert back to concentration, remember that concentration is a ratio of millimoles, right? We had 32.5 millimoles of base. I'm going to leave room for my volume. We had 42.5 millimoles of our acid and room for volume down here. So recognize that both of those solutions are in the same volume of solution. And in fact, if we go back to the original problem, we had 75 mils of the acid of the buffer and 5 mils of the strong acid. So our solution has a total volume of 80.0 milliliters. Well, since they're in the same volume of solution, dividing by that volume is just going to cancel out. So just to show the rest of our equation here, we have the full Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, but to convert back to molarity doesn't make any sense because that volume is always going to be the same. And so in our Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, when we have base over acid listed here, those units can be molarity. They can be moles if you're using moles, or we can use just millimoles. So either one of these, any one of these units are acceptable for the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Oh, sorry, I had a rounding error. My apologies. Our final pH after rounding is 4.63. Again, we're going to two decimal places because of the two sig figs in our values. In our next video, we will describe the pH calculation for adding a strong base to a buffer.